Hello everyone, welcome to my channel ECE Scholastic. I am Jasmine Vichitra. Today we are going to start a new subject named Discrete Time Signal Processing. So I am going to give you an introduction about Unit 1, which is Discrete Fourier Transform. We are not going deep into the topic, but I will give you a small introduction about this digital signal processing. As you know, Unit 1 is Discrete Fourier Transform. I'm going to divide this unit into four sections. The first section is Review of Signals and Systems, which clearly talks about what is a signal, what is a system, and the basic concepts behind signals and systems. I'm not going to cover much in this topic since we have learned this already in Control Systems and Signals and Systems subject. The second one is Discrete Fourier Transform and its properties. Here we will be discussing the basic of discrete Fourier transform and the properties that we are going to use in our subject. And the third one is filtering long data sequence using convolution. So this topic mainly focuses on convolution and various techniques that has been involved in convolution. Okay. The final one is fast Fourier transform. So here we will be seeing the comparison between fast Fourier transform as well as discrete Fourier transform, and we will come to a conclusion that which transformation is better and which is mostly used and what are the advantages of one transform with the other transform. So let's move on to the titles that we are going to cover today. So first we will see what is a signal, second we will see what is a system, and third we will see what is the meaning of digital signal processing and why we are going for it, and fourth we will see what are the basic elements of DSP, and fifth we will see what are the advantages, disadvantages and applications of DSP. So let's start with our first topic, signal. So what is a signal? As we know, signal is a quantity that carries some information. Technically speaking, signal is a physical quantity that carries some information. That information varies with respect to time, space, and other dependent or independent variables. Okay. So the signals can be broadly classified into continuous time and discrete time signals, deterministic and non-deterministic signals, which can also be called as random signals, energy and power signals, even and odd signals, which can also be called as symmetric and asymmetric signals, periodic and aperiodic signals, real and imaginary signals. Okay. Now, let me give you some examples for signals. So, can you see this picture? This picture represents the speech signal. Okay. Let me show you another example. So, this is a brain signal and this is a heart signal. So, we can commonly call it as a biomedical signal. Okay. Next is a man is playing a guitar. So, guitar is a musical instrument. So, the signal is a musical signal. Noise or sound is reaching a person's ear, which is called as a noise signal or a sound signal. In this, a kid is watching a television. So, this can also be called as a video signal or an image signal. Okay. Finally, a signal is a radar signal, which is helpful for the airplanes to go in the specific track. Okay. So if we combinedly see all these examples, we can say that our environment is full of signals that is giving us some information. Okay. So that's all about signal. Now let's move on to the another classification of signals. That is, the signals can be broadly classified into four categories. First one is analog signal. Next is continuous time signal. Next is discrete time signal. And next is digital signal. Let's see all these signals one by one. Let me start with the analog signal. Here you can see a waveform. This waveform has an x-axis as well as the y-axis. Let's say that the x-axis represents x and the y-axis represents amplitude, or we can say a function of x. So how can we define this analog signal? If the time scale as well as the amplitude scale are continuous, then we can say it is an analog signal. That is, x is also continuous. The function f of x, that is y-axis, is also a continuous function. Okay. Next is continuous time signal. If you see this, you can say that the x is continuous, okay, and f of x function, that is y of t, is discrete. We can see a step signal here. So the amplitude is discrete, only the x-axis is continuous. Okay. Next is discrete time signal. So if you see this discrete time signal, we can say that x is discrete, that is the sample is discrete, only the amplitude is continuous. Okay, next is digital signal. So if you see this digital signal, both the amplitude as well as the time, or both the amplitude as well as the samples are discrete. On comparing all these four signals, we can say that discrete time signal holds a big advantage other signals, because in digital signal, if you see the waveform we have drawn and the signals that are transmitted, you can see there is a loss of data, correct? So here loss is more in digital signal, and in analog signal, the analog signals are easily affected by noise. So we can say that there will be more loss in analog signal and there will be more data loss in digital signal. Okay. So that's all about the category of signal and its classifications. Now let's move on to the system. So as you know, what is a system? A system is a set of components that are connected together to perform a single task. Okay. Technically speaking, we can define a system as a physical device that performs an operation on a signal. See the classification of systems. So the systems are classified into linear and non-linear systems, time variant and time invariant systems, invertible and non-invertible systems, static and dynamic systems, causal and non-causal systems, stable and unstable systems. Let me tell you in detail about the systems. That is, let me show you an example. If you see here, this is a waveform. So we have a reference line in the middle. To the left side, we can see a wave with noise. To the right side, we can see the exact waveform. Correct. So what happens in this reference line? The signal which is transmitted is affected by noise, which is shown in the left side, and the noise is removed in the right hand side. Correct. So we can say that we are processing a signal by removing the noise with the help of a filter. So we are processing the signal to do certain modifications in the signal to extract the exact information of the original signal. Right. So this concept is called a signal processing. So now here comes the need for processing a signal. Okay. Now let's move on to the concepts behind the signal processing. So here I am considering a signal. So the signal is need to be processed in order to filter the noise and to extract the original information. To perform all these steps, I am in need of a mathematical operation. So once I identify the mathematical operation, I will process the signal with the help of a hardware, which is we are considering here a digital computer. Okay, so in order to process the signal in this digital computer, we need some softwares. So this software has to do some coding on the basis of the mathematical operations that are to be performed on the signal. Correct. So as a whole, we can say that a digital system is a combination of a hardware as well as a software. And say this is completely an embedded system, that is a combination of a digital hardware as well as a software. Okay. Now let's see what are the basic elements of digital signal processing. Most of the signals in the universe are analog in nature, that is continuous in amplitude as well as time. Correct. Now giving an analog input signal to an analog processor, we will get the analog output signal. The analog signal processor may be a filter, a frequency analyzer, or a frequency multiplier. Right. So as a whole, we can say the input as well as the output signal are in analog form. But we know that the analog signals are easily affected by the environment, such that most of the data can get lost while transmitting. Right. So here comes the need of processing the signal to remove the data and to extract the exact information. For that, we are in need of a digital signal processor. We need to process the signal digitally to obtain the accurate results in a reliable format. So as we said earlier, we have an analog input signal as well as the output also will be in analog form. Right. But in order to make this, or in order to process the signal, we need a digital signal processor. the input to the digital signal processor must be a digital input and the output from the digital signal processor is a digital output, right? So, in order to convert this analog input into a digital input, we need an interface between this analog input and a digital signal processor. So, we are using a block called as A2D converter, which is analog to digital converter. And also, we need analog output, right? But the output of digital signal processor is digital output. So, in order to convert this digital output to an analog output, we need an interface between these two, which is a D2A converter, which is a digital to analog converter. So, what actually happens in this A2D converter? The continuous time signals are splitted into samples and the samples are quantized. And quantized means we will assign binary values. So, here happens a coding. Correct. So, what comes out of the digital signal processor is the digital output. So, this coding, that is the coded signals, are encoded with the help of this D2A converter, which in turn converts the digital signal into an analog output. But some applications that supports the digital output signal will stop the process here itself. For example, I can give you a radar application. So, for a radar application, we need only digital output. A D2A converter is not required. In the case of speech communication signals, we are in need of an analog output. So, here comes the need of digital to analog converter, right? So, these are the basic elements of a digital signal processor. I hope that you understood the concept clearly. Now, let me tell you the advantages or the other sides of the digital signal processor. As we know, digital signal processor is a combination of hardware as well as the software, right? It is an embedded system. So, what happens in the hardware and what happens in the software? So, as a software side, we use a large programmable digital computer or a small microprocessor. Okay, all these are flexible in the sense we can do programming based on our applications, so that if the application is different, then we can do or we can alter the programs based upon our application. So, this is most commonly used platform of digital signal processor. But when comparing to this hardware digital processor, it is difficult to reconfigure, which means it will be specifically designed for a particular application. Okay, if the application is differ, then the hardware component is also differ. Correct. So, the signal operations are completely based upon the hardware design. But we have an advantage here, that is, once the system is designed, we can optimize the system and we can optimize the performance in the further levels. So, we can say that this is very cheap. It runs faster and we will get better outputs within a short period of time. Okay. So, comparatively, we can say hardware digital processor can be optimized and it is not time consuming. But the large programmable digital computer or a small microprocessor, that is the programmable one, is a time consuming task. Okay. Now, let's discuss the basic operations of DSP. So, the basic operations of DSP are convolution, correlation, filtering, transformations and modulation. Convolution, you know what happens in convolution. We will multiply two inputs to find the third signal. Okay. Which means we will measure the effect of one signal on the other signal and we will obtain the third signal, which is called as convolution. The convolution can be broadly classified into two types, linear convolution and circular convolution, which can also be called as periodic and non-periodic. We will discuss all these in detail in further sections. Next is correlation. So, what happens in correlation? Correlation measures the similarity between two signals or sequences. So, the correlation can also be classified into two types, cross-correlation and autocorrelation. We will also discuss this in detail in the further sessions. Next is filtering. So, what is filtering? Filtering is removal of noise, correct? So, the noise elements from the prescribed signal is removed to obtain the original signal. For that purpose, we are using filtering. Next is transformation. What is transformation? Transformation is transforming from one domain to the another domain. So, here we will be converting the signal from time domain to frequency domain, or we can do vice versa. Okay, so that is about transformation. Finally, we are going to see modulation. So, what is modulation? When a high frequency carrier signal is mixed with a modulating signal, the original signal can be extracted by the process of modulation. So that's all about the basic DSP operations, right? Next, we will see the advantages, disadvantages and applications of DSP. Since we have covered what are the basic concepts behind DSP, we can easily pinpoint the advantages and disadvantages, also the applications. So what are the advantages? We can guarantee the accuracy. In digital system, the informations are transmitted in the form of bits. Bits means it is highly accurate. Okay. Next is perfect reproducibility. What is the meaning of this? Even if we do a number of alterations, if we cut, if we edit, if we do some alterations in the signal, the originality of the signal is not affected. So we can easily reproduce the original signal. Okay. Next is no drift in performance with temperature or age. Even after years, if we are generating the same signal, the signal will have the same performance and same characteristics. It will not decay or there will not be any deformities. Okay. So we can say there is no drift in performance. Okay. Next is semiconductor technology. Since we are using this microcontrollers, microprocessors, they are manufactured with the help of the semiconductor technology. We can say that they are small in size, cheap, greater reliability and lower power consumption, and also it offers high speed. Okay. Next is greater flexibility, which means we can perform programming based on the application and also we can design the hardware component based on the specific application. Correct. So we can say it is highly flexible. And the final one is superior performance. So when compared to the analog processors, digital processors gives a better performance in case of all the advantages we have discussed so far. Okay. Next is the disadvantages. Major disadvantage of this processor is costly. Because if we concentrate on speed, based upon the speed, the system cost is also get increased. Okay. Next is design time is more, which means in programmable side, it will require more time to do the programmings for the application. Okay. Next is finite word length effect problems, which means we will be using this quantization technique. Quantization in the sense we will have to process truncation as well as rounding off. So when we fix the number of bits that is being transmitted, there will occur some problem which is called as finite word length effects. We will discuss in the forthcoming sessions. So that's all about the disadvantages. The final one is application. As you know, we all are surrounded by signals. So all the domain that surrounds us are completely based on the DSP application. Here I have listed out a few application area, that is image processing, instrumentation control, military, speech, audio, telecommunication and biomedical applications. So in this session we have seen what is a signal, what is a system, why we are going for signal processing, what is a DSP processor, what are the basic elements of it, what are the basic operations performed in the DSP processor. Finally, we have discussed the advantages, disadvantages and applications. If you have any doubts in this section, please comment me or you can mail to my mail ID. Thank you for your patience in listening. I hope you will enjoy this series of DSP classes in the further sessions. Thank you. Be safe. Have a great day.